Hello, and welcome to the TI Precision Lab, discussing op-amp bandwidth, Part 4. In this video, we'll cover five bandwidth-related topics. First, a deeper look at how the slope of the AOL curve affects gain bandwidth. Second, how an op-amp's input capacitance can limit the bandwidth. Third, how to calculate the practical gain versus frequency for amplifier circuits. Fourth, how to limit the bandwidth of a circuit using a feedback capacitor. And finally, how slew rate can affect the circuit's response over frequency.
At this point, we have discussed the gain bandwidth product in great detail. We know that it is only valid where the slope of the AOL curve is minus 20 dB per decade. Unfortunately, sometimes it is not obvious whether the gain bandwidth product is valid or not. Here we have the gain bandwidth product specification from the OPA 209 datasheet. The typical gain bandwidth product is listed as 18 MHz, given that the gain is 1 volt per volt. But what about for other closed loop gains? Here we have the open loop gain and phase curve versus frequency from the datasheet. The open loop gain curve appears to be linear and decreasing at a constant rate of minus 20 dB per decade. Thus, one might assume that the gain bandwidth product is valid for all closed-loop gains. However, simulation and real-world measurements will show that such an assumption is incorrect. Why? Previously, we assumed that the open-loop gain curve had a constant slope of minus 20 dB per decade. However, we find that there is a small bend in the AOL curve between 1 MHz and 10 MHz due to a pole zero pair. A pole near 1 MHz causes the open loop gain to decrease faster than minus 20 dB per decade over a small range of frequency, but the pole is then quickly canceled by a zero. Due to the logarithmic scale, it is not possible to see this small bend in the AOL curve. As a matter of fact, the bend is probably smaller than the thickness of the line in the curve. Zooming in on the bend in the curve, you will notice that the gain bandwidth is 18 MHz at the specified gain of 1 volt per volt, but increases to 23.7 MHz for closed loop gains greater than 20 dB. While the bend in the AOL curve is difficult, if not impossible to see, the pole zero pair is more apparent in the phase curve. Notice the dip in the phase curve near 1 MHz. This is due to the pole zero pair. Therefore, it is recommended that one always inspect the phase curve in addition to the gain curve in an op-amp datasheet. These two curves depict how the gain bandwidth product changes with frequency and closed-loop gain. Notice that at a closed-loop gain of 0 dB, or 1 volt per volt, the gain bandwidth product is 18 MHz, as stated in the datasheet. As the closed-loop gain increases, the bandwidth increases to 23.7 MHz. Ultimately, there are three lessons to learn from this discussion. First, it is not unusual to see some deviation in gain bandwidth for different closed-loop gains, and that the amount of deviation will vary depending on the amplifier. Second, the phase curve is key to locating the existence of a pole zero pair, so always be sure to inspect the phase curve in addition to the open loop gain curve. Finally, don't expect the exact bandwidth performance listed in the datasheet. Typical bandwidth specifications can vary by approximately plus or minus 30% over process, and an additional plus or minus 30% over temperature. Therefore, it is highly recommended to include significant margin for bandwidth in your design. Up to this point, we have seen how the op-amp's gain bandwidth limitation sets the bandwidth. However, in some cases, other factors can affect bandwidth. This slide focuses on the effect of input capacitance on bandwidth. All op-amps will have a differential and common mode input capacitance and impedance. This parasitic capacitance is from the semiconductor junctions on the input stage transistors. The differential capacitance is connected between the two inputs, and the common mode capacitance is connected on each input with respect to AC ground. The table at the top of the slide shows how input capacitance is typically specified. In this example, the differential capacitance is 1.6 picofarads, and the common mode capacitance is 6.4 picofarads. These input capacitances are relatively small, so it is unlikely that you will see bandwidth limitations unless the input signal source has a large series resistance. In this example, the source resistance is 1 megaohm, which is relatively large. The source resistance and common mode input capacitance form a low-pass filter. The corresponding cutoff frequency is calculated to be 24.87 kHz. Notice that the differential capacitance and the common mode capacitance on the inverting input are not included in the bandwidth calculation. This is because the op-amp feedback eliminates the effect of these capacitances. The input capacitance is part of TI's op-amp macro models, so let's take a look at some simulation results. This slide shows an AC transfer characteristic sweep for the OPA192. Based on the gain bandwidth of the device and the circuit's closed-loop gain of 100 volts per volt, or 40 dB, we expect 100 kHz of bandwidth. Our simulation, however, yields a bandwidth of 24.46 kHz. This discrepancy is due to the low-pass filter formed by the 1 megaohm source resistance and the 6.4 picofarad common mode input capacitance. In this example, the hand-calculated bandwidth of 24.87 kHz correlates with the simulated bandwidth of 24.6 kHz. Now let's discuss how to calculate the practical gain of an op-amp circuit. It is often assumed that the closed-loop gain of an amplifier circuit is constant until it starts to roll off at the cutoff frequency. In reality, the closed-loop gain begins to decrease long before the cutoff frequency. The error introduced by this attenuation is usually unexpected. The closed-loop gain at any frequency can be calculated using this equation, where f is frequency, gcl dc is the DC closed-loop gain, fdom is the dominant pole, beta is the feedback factor, and AOL dc is the DC open-loop gain. Let's use this equation and apply it to the OPA192 circuit. The closed-loop DC gain is calculated using 126 dB, which is the AOL specification from the OPA192 datasheet, and the feedback factor, or beta, from the OPA192 circuit. The dominant pole is calculated using this equation, which was given in a previous bandwidth video. Now that we've calculated the closed-loop DC gain and dominant pole frequency, we can use the given equation to calculate the closed-loop gain at 10 kHz. Note that the bandwidth for this circuit is 100 kHz, so 10 kHz is well inside the bandwidth of the amplifier. In this example, the hand-calculated closed-loop gain is 99.5 volts per volt, which correlates well with the simulated closed-loop gain of 99.56 volts per volt. Calculating the closed-loop gain at DC yields 99.995 volts per volt, which is even closer to the theoretical value of 100 volts per volt. Therefore, we can conclude that as frequency increases, the closed-loop gain decreases as you approach the cutoff frequency. So if a design requires a precise gain at higher frequencies, the cutoff frequency should be increased accordingly. So far, we have considered internal op-amp specifications, such as gain bandwidth and input capacitance, when determining a circuit's bandwidth. In some cases, it is desirable to use external components to limit bandwidth. One approach is to use active filters, which use complex RC combinations to create very effective filters. Active filters will be discussed in a separate series of videos. A simpler method for limiting a circuit's bandwidth is by placing a capacitor in the feedback path. For this analysis, it is best to think of the capacitor as an open circuit for low frequencies and a short circuit at high frequencies. At low frequencies, you can ignore the capacitor in the circuit, so the gain will be 100 volts per volt, or 40 dB. At high frequencies, the capacitor will short the 99 kiloohm resistor, so the amplifier circuit will have a gain of 1 volt per volt, or 0 dB. Between the low and high frequencies, the gain will roll off at a rate of minus 20 dB per decade. Note that at very high frequencies, the gain will roll off further because of the amplifier's bandwidth limitations. Note that the cutoff frequency of the filter is set by the feedback capacitor and feedback resistor. The calculated value is 1.005 kHz, which correlates well with the simulated value of 989 Hz. It is important to note that the filter reduced the gain from 40 dB to 0 dB. The attenuation is dependent on the gain of the amplifier. Let's take a closer look at this. This slide compares how the feedback capacitor filter works for amplifiers in high and low gain. In both cases, the cutoff frequency is set to the same value. As mentioned before, at high frequency, the feedback capacitor filter effectively shorts the feedback resistor, which forces the gain to 1 volt per volt. So the feedback capacitor filter will always reduce the gain from the DC value to 1. Thus, the maximum attenuation of the filter equals the DC gain. In the case of the high gain circuit, the gain is attenuated from 100 volts per volt to 1 volt, or 40 dB. The low gain circuit, however, only attenuates the gain by 6 dB. The point is that the feedback capacitor filter is most effective for higher gain circuits. If you need an effective filter for low gain circuits, you should probably look into an active filter. In general, active filters are more effective than a feedback capacitor filter, but the feedback capacitor filters are popular because they are simple and inexpensive. Finally, let's discuss slew rate and full power bandwidth. The slew rate of an op amp is the maximum rate of change of the output signal. If you're interested in learning about the details of slew rate, please view the slew rate video series. The slew rate of a device can affect how an op amp behaves over frequency, and this effect can be misinterpreted as a bandwidth limitation. In fact, the maximum output voltage versus frequency depends on the slew rate and is often called full power bandwidth. Let's look at how the full power bandwidth affects two different signals applied to the OPA-192 unity gain follower. The graph of maximum output voltage versus frequency tells what maximum undistorted peak-to-peak output can be achieved at a given frequency. For example, let's apply a 1 volt peak signal at a frequency of 1 megahertz. This signal is well below the maximum output limitation, so there should be no distortion. However, a 10 volt peak signal at a frequency of 1 megahertz is outside the full power bandwidth, so the signal will be distorted. Now let's look at a time domain simulation to see how the output is affected in both cases. This slide shows the OPA-192 output with a 10 volt peak and 1 volt peak input at 1 megahertz. Notice that the output for a 1 volt peak input is 1 volt peak as expected. Also, the 1 volt peak output does not appear distorted. The output for the 10 volt peak input, however, is 5 volts peak and appears very distorted. In fact, the output looks more like a triangle wave than a sinusoidal wave. This is often the case for amplifiers that are in slew rate limit. These results make sense based on the full power bandwidth graph from the previous slide. One final thing to notice is that the input signal is well inside the bandwidth of the OPA-192 buffer. Sometimes attenuation of the output signal caused by slew rate limitation is incorrectly interpreted as a bandwidth limitation. To avoid this problem, always make sure that your output signal amplitude does not violate the maximum output voltage versus frequency graph in the datasheet. In summary, this video discussed how the slope of the AOL curve affects the gain bandwidth, op-amp input capacitance, calculating the practical gain of a circuit, slew rate limitations, and some simple ways to implement an op-amp filter. Thank you for your time. Please try the quiz to check your understanding of this video's content.